Am I
Yes, I've
audible?
started the recording.
Now?
Yes, you are audible. And
Okay.
I've started recording also.
Okay. Good afternoon and welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for Media Watch webinar series. Is there a disturbance, Jyoti? Please, just if you can say.
You carry on, everything is okay. Please carry on.
Okay. I'm sorry. Good afternoon and thanks for joining Media Watch webinar series. My name is Autoshi Bhattacharya and I'm a faculty in Department of Journalism and Mass Communications, Surendranath College for Women. Today we are presenting on statistical analysis using R. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box. We will have a question and answer session at the end to answer to your questions. Link for the feedback will also be provided in the chat box. Participants are requested to fill up the feedback form for receiving their e-certificates. So let me begin by inviting Mr. Sashi Bhushan Nayak, who is the review editor of Media Watch and also a lecturer in a college in Odisha. So Nayak sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Very good afternoon to all of you. I believe Media Watch as a journal needs no introduction, but yet it's the formality and the format of the webinar, so we have to go with that. Media Watch is a double-blind, peer-reviewed, tri-annual journal published by Center for Academic Social Action from Puri. We started in 2010. Initially, we published two issues in a year. In the year 2013, we increased our frequency to 3 issues a year. The journal has both print and online edition. The journal keeps high quality peer evaluation and academic standards in all levels of its publication. And the current international standing in terms of the indexing, in terms of the citation metrics, it is indexed in Scopus and we are ranked 7th in language and literature category out of 823 journals. And in language and linguistics, we are ranked 114 out of 830 journals. In linguistics and language, we are 127 in Scopus Q1. And in social sciences, that to communication, we are ranked 109 in the Scopus database. So I welcome all the team members and all the speakers, including Umakant sir and Tirthankar sir, for this webinar. And I hope this webinar will be a grand success like the last one. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us today, sir. Thanks for sharing about Media Watch. Moving forward, we are very privileged and honored to have Dr. Tirthankar Ghosh with us and Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey with us. Dr. Tirthankar Ghosh is an associate assistant professor, stage 3, Department of Statistics, Shiksha Bhavan, Shantiniketan, West Bengal. And we are really very proud to have him today, very honored to have him today. Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey is the editor of Media Watch, IMCR ambassador, and Dr. Pandey, sir, is associate professor and head department of journalism and mass communication, Surendranath College for Women, Kolkata. I would like to welcome, sir, to say a few words. Over to you, sir.
If you can see my screen, without any further ado, I will start presenting on today's topic. So the first basic part will be done by me, and then we'll go to Dr. Ghosh for the real statistical part. I can only see the screen. If there's a problem, kindly let me know on audio. So welcome to the world of R. It's a very powerful and versatile statistical tool, not only for statistics, it's for many more. You know, it can do a lot more things, including data visualization, machine learning, which of course is, you know, kind of an applied statistical part, and lots more. We'll see about that. It is open source, it is easy access, it is well supported. I will explain these words as I go along. So very quickly, one to go on you know, downloading that and showing the demo of that. So it works basically on an R base, and there are a lot of packages provided by users from you know, across the world. Packs are so very useful. So it started, the first stable version of R started in 2000. A lot of people say it's the new S language. So it came from S, that's what people do. But as I said, the community work is what keeps the program up to date. And there are of packages we'll keep on talking about. There are a lot of data sets, exercise data sets as part of R base as well, which we will show as we go along. So it's an open source high level programming language. I'll just explain what high level programming language means. So the user community is, as I keep saying, the user community is what keeps R up to date, and it has all the quality tools that's required for data analytics. Why do we say it's a high level programming language? So compared to you know, languages like C, for example, where you have to start coding from, here we already have predefined functions and object classes. So the user does not need to code from scratch. And if I have to talk in terms of, you know, our everyday language, then this is one language. This is one computer language we can which can understand, you know, kind of human language more clearly. Human language in terms of the words that we use. So we'll talk about, you know, these you know, functions of R as well. So this is what R can do, or this is what we keep doing with R. We'll just talk about a very few of these things. So it does, you know, we can enter data here. We can pre-process almost everything, you know, about statistical analysis can be done here. We can do data simulations, visualizations, even web scraping, and, you know, from social media as well. And you also have it for website integration. Alternatives, of course, are MATLAB, Minitab. Everybody knows about that. SAS, SPSS, almost everybody present here would have worked on SPSS at some point of time. And MS Excel also, which is a general data analytics program. Now let's start getting into the details of R. So I will talk about these six type of vectors. The complex and raw are the ones that are very less used. So integers are like, you know, whole numbers. So when we're talking of 1, 2, 3, 4, or, you know, exact whole numbers, that's an integer. The term double is all, you know, at times used interchangeably for numeric, but they are two different things. We'll explain what it means. So when we have numeric, when we have decimals, we talk of double. We talk of characters or strings, as we say in other languages, and the logical or the Boolean, data types. So these are the four that we work with. The other two are not that popular, you know, as far as our work is concerned. But in mathematics and all, complex data is required. Raw data would be about the binary data itself. This is another way of saying it. So instead of saying the double, we are saying this is numeric. So again, you know, I'll repeat, we're talking about logical, we're talking about integers, we're talking of characters, and we're talking of numeric. I'll explain that as I, you know, get to demonstrate this. There are three different types of brackets, and all these brackets have different usages. And I will explain that, you know, in my part of presentation. The round bracket, which is a standard one, and it's mainly used to bind you know, values together within a function or an object. The box brackets are basically for, you know, data filtering or slicing, or, you know, finding out one part of data from a bigger data set. Curly bracket is used for self-designed functions. In fact, I will try and show at least one function as well to show the work of curly brackets. So be very careful about these three different brackets. They mean very different things. As in other languages like Python, for example, the boxes mean very different things. The brackets, different kinds of brackets mean very different things. Before we start, these are three things that I want to emphasize about, you know, downloading and activating packages. So as we know, there is one R base, and on that base we download packages. So downloading and activating it into your workspace is another thing. So we have to be very careful about that. You downloaded that and you did not activate in your workspace, it might not work. R is very case sensitive. So we work with passwords very often, and we know, just like passwords, R is case sensitive. So if we use a wrong case, we are not going to get it. Concatenation is another thing. I will explain why this is so very important. So at times when we are not using that small C, and we might land in big trouble. So even before starting that, you know, I wanted you to have a note of these three very important things. Then we'll have, you know, we assign certain numbers to all these objects. So when we use those signs, basically we are assigning them. So say, for example, if I'm assigning the number 3 to the first place on X, this is what I'll be doing. So just remember, I'll show it to you on the RStudio interface. So basically, we assign values to this object. So this is what we do. So it does not mean that it is equal to something. It means that this object contains these numbers in a particular order, or it might not be a particular order as well. And then we'll talk about, basically here, we'll talk about vectors and matrices and data frames. Of course, lists and array also we'll discuss in passing. So basically, this is what I would want to do. And before getting into all the details, we'll have to, first of all, know what to download, how to download, where to download it from. So I'll very quickly show you, how to download, R and RStudio, and then we'll get into the basics of it. So let's. For some reason, I got logged out. I'm again, very sorry. So, right. So just let me very quickly show you the. I had kept all the Chrome tabs ready and all, and then this is what happens. So I'm just straightway taking where you can download R for Windows. This is where you have to do. You just go for Cran R project, or and then there's a download for Windows. You download it from this comprehensive R archive network. And there's a download R for Windows button. You just press it, and then you'll get the R basic, with the one that I showed you right at the beginning. So that's what we start with. And then once you've downloaded that, we also need an R editor, and that R editor is the RStudio. So this is what you have to download. The first part is the archive network, and this is what you have to download, the free part. There are a lot of other parts here as well. That's not what we require. So once you've downloaded that, you'll get something like what we're going to show you right now. So I'm going a little fast because I don't want it to be, just. Wasting time on other details. Yeah, somebody wanted me to show. So yeah, so you just go to R Studio. This is the one that I was just showing. And then, before that, you are downloading it from the CRAN network. you're downloading R for Windows. You just type R for Windows, and that's what you will get. So I think that's a very, very easiest part of it. I don't think that I have to spend time on that, do I? Right. Please stop somebody. Sarwani ji, can you just remove your presentation? Who is Sarwani ji? Yeah. So this is where we are. Now, before we start working, we have to, make sure that it is, this particular format. Since I was already working, so I have, arranged it in this particular format. So let me just, before I start working, explain it to you a little bit. So this is where the, console is. This is where the entire work happens. This is your workspace. If you can see this, my mouse cursor, this is the workspace. This the environment, and this is where all the files and the plots and everything that we show will happen. So this particular thing is what if you're using just the R base, or if you're just using the real R kernel, if you're not downloading R Studio, R Studio is a optional thing. You could be working just from the basic R kernel that was downloaded, but I'm not going there because I have to keep on sharing one screen and the others. I'm not going to put that particular screen right away. This is what our screen looks like. So before we start working, we have to set a working directory there. It's very important that we set the working directory right before we start. Otherwise, there'll be lots of problems as we go along. So set working directory. I have, set it to the source file location. So as I said, we are using this RStudio, which provides us with a GUI interface. Otherwise, I would have to type this in code, set working directory within brackets, inverted commas, D colon R files, etc. Otherwise, I'll just be going here and setting the working directory. You go to session, you go to set working directory, and you source it, save it to the source file location. Why am I saving it to the source file location? Again, very quickly, so that all the files which are there, I will have a very, very easy way of getting the files onto my workspace, and I can work with that. And there will I don't have to specify its directory all the time. So be very careful that all the files are saved on your working directory, so that you can access the file just by typing in the name of the particular file in a CSV format or whatever. This is one of the most powerful workspaces you will see. Starting off with, say, for example, it's a very good calculator. For example, whatever you can think of. Say, for example, 50 multiplied by 2 minus 36 after we type in whatever number we are trying to, we have to make it run. And this is the value I get. So it will apply automatically, whatever the Bodmas rules or whatever are, it will be applied automatically. You can be doing, any kind of a thing. You can be doing, 5 base 3. So first of all, very quickly, this is one giant calculator. It can calculate anything that I want to. So what do I do? Just type in whatever I have to. This is what I get. It's a giant. Huh?
Someone is presenting their screen, please. Yes, sir. It's removed.
I've removed.
So it might happen. Please make sure you don't remove someone important.
Yes, sir. Sir, they can rejoin, of course.
Okay. Right. Am I back? Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Please, yeah, please respond immediately, right? So I can also, you know, perform logarithmic functions. I know that log of 100 is 2. So I just have to perform that function. I type in and then I press Control Enter. I get the value. If you can see down there. So this is one giant calculator. It can perform logarithmic functions. It can perform trigonometric functions. It can perform anything that you want. Now let me start explaining the concatenate function. So, and you know, as I go along, I will introduce you to vectors, matrices, data frame, and also, you know, the data type. Say, for example, as I said, you know, just remember the X example. I said when I put in an object and I put in numbers there, there's a particular syntax, there's a particular way of writing it. If you can't see it, what I'll do is I will zoom it. Is this visible better?
Yes, sir.
Right. So let me show you this way. So I'm assigning these values to X. I'm not using, say, for example, I'm not using the value C here. I'm just writing 2, 3, 5. As you can say, this is saying it's an unexpected token. So it requires, you know, some kind of a concatenation there. So if I press C over here and then I run it by finding out what is X, it will tell me X is 2, 3, and 5. Very quickly, let's try and see another function. As I said, you know, I'm trying to put in a lot of functions in the half an hour that I'll take for you. So for example, I plot the timeline of X and I press Control Enter. This is the timeline I get on the plot axis. Can you see this here?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So what I did was that I, you know, assigned these three numbers to X, 2, 3, and 5. Assigning, you know, I can also use an equals to sign, or I can use other ways. There are three ways in which I can assign, but this is what we generally do. We type less than, and then we type this dash. And then this function is C, which is the most important function. If I don't use this C, then I'm not creating a vector. Then these are just simple numbers. I'll just show you what it means. Say, for example, I'm plotting the same numbers again. But this time, I just write the numbers. And say I want to run this. Running, as I said, is done by two ways. Either I just bring the cursor to the end of this particular line and press run. Or I can do Control Enter. As you can see, I cannot run this because it says that argument must be null or character vector or whatever. Because I did not use a concatenate function there, it is not seeing this as a unit. It is not seeing that 2, 3, and 5 are together. It is seeing it as something else. That is why this plot was not possible. But the moment I use C over here, and I run it, I can get this plot again here. If it is not showing any error, that means it is working. If I want to find out what is this, if you remember, I spoke of double and numericals. So it by default, see, although I have used single integers here, 2, 3, and 5, but R is saying it, taking it as a numerical. It is taking the default value is that it will take it as a numerical. So if I see it here, it will show me that it is a numerical over here. It's an integer. So the default thing it will take is an integer. If I have default thing, is, I'm sorry, it will take it as a numerical. If I want to take it as an integer, then I'll have to do something else. Let me show you very quickly some of the other things that R can do. I can, you know, instead of typing in all the numbers, I can just type in a series. And sorry, yeah. And then I want to find out what is X. I run it. It shows me it is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And now if I want to see what is the type of X, you have to type just a little bit. rest of it will be shown by RStudio. It will show you how to complete it, just like the autocomplete option that we have. Now you can see it is showing it's an integer. Can you see the difference? Earlier, when I was, you know, just taking the concatenate function, it was showing that it is a double or it's a numerical. That means it was seeing it as a decimal thing, which did not have a decimal. But when I use this, you know, sequence kind of a thing, it is taking it as a integer. There are other ways of, you know, coercing R to accept it as, you know, certain things or whatever. But this is one way of finding out, you know, what type my X is. So here I have assigned X a value of 1 to 5. But since I'm using this, you know, colon function, it is taking it as a vector. Here I'm taking it, I'm using the C function, it is taking it as a vector. So as you can see, this bracket, the first bracket that I spoke of, it you know, concatenates, or it brings it together, or it combines these three values into one vector. And each place, you know, is important here. I will talk about these places in a moment's time. So what we're doing here, we are assigning values to this object, and we are, you know, recalling these values. I showed you one way of, you know, plotting this on a time scale. So this is a time scale. It could be 1 minute, you know, 1.5 minute, 2 minute, or hours, or whatever. And you know, whatever values I was taking, could be taking any value, you know, it can go down. And, you know, you can just see for yourself. Here it has gone down. As you can see, the plot, you know, it's just an exact thing of whatever I have put in here. But if you remember the pitfall that I spoke of, if I do not use C, then this is useless. This is not going to work. So that's one very simple part of it. R also has very, easy ways of, say, for example, I just want to show you this part. If you do not use C, then the problem. So these are all built-in functions, as you can see. I'm just using the built-in functions there. We have a mean function as well. You see, can you see this curly bracket here? It's written base here, so it is there in the base. And just, you know, I'll just, you know, finish in another 10 minutes. I'll, you know, because Dr. Ghosh is waiting and we have to, you know, give him more time. So this is there in the base. If I use these values to calculate mean, by pressing Control Enter, it is showing the mean is 10, which obviously is wrong. The mean of 10, 15, 20, and 25 can't be 10 because we are not using a concatenate function. It is taking it as something else. So the moment I use this, and I Control Enter, I can see the mean is 17.5, which is the correct mean. So I can assign that mean to an object. I can say that the mean is y less than and the dash. And then I can find out what is y. It's the same thing. It will give me the same value. Since I have y, I can find out what is it, or I can, you know, type in class, or I can just find out what is it a type of y. It will show me. What do you think it will show me? It is a double, because as you can see, it's a, it has a decimal place. It is, and by default, it is taking it as a numeric. We also have you know, we can also work with sequences. So just let me talk about two sequences. Although we use it very often in R, I'm just trying to show you, you know, this is what R can do. One, three, five, seven, nine. There are arguments there. I'm not going to talk about that. But, you know, the first thing is the, you know, starting number. The second thing is the, you know, ending number. And by 2 means I'm increasing it by 2. If I increase it by 3, then I'll be getting 1, 4, 7, things like that. Just see this. If I use it by 3, then I'll be getting it like. So we can create, you know, sequences. We can create repetitions. We can, you know, all these things. In fact, it does not have to be a whole number. We can, you know, increase these sequences in terms of pi as well. And pi, as you know, is a 3 point whatever. So if you, as you can see, it has increased by 1, and then it is 4.141593. So as you can see, they're using up to six decimal places. So this is one way of running sequences. So this is the second part of it, how to bring in numbers, or how to, create sequences or repetitions. We can create repetitions also. In fact, if I take, the sequence of 1.75 to 5.2125 by 0.05, then it will, increase by all the terms there. And if I, just write sequence 17, it will be, then by default, it takes that it's starting from 17. Just let me show you. If I just show sequence 17 and I enter it, it will show me all the numbers from 1 to 17, because it has already taken the first argument there as 1, which is the default argument. So whenever we type in something, or whenever we want to find out about something, the best way is to go to this question mark, SEQ. And it will show me, in the help thing, it will tell me what is a sequence, or how to, as you can see, this is a sequence generation. So this is one very easy way of doing it. So as you can see, these are the arguments. The first one is from, the second one is to, the third one is by. These are the arguments. And here you have, I didn't write from and to, but even then R has taken it. If you can see this clearly, let me zoom in a little bit. This is what the R is, the sequence is equal to, by what next step. So this is the default argument. This is there in R. But if I don't specify from and to, even, and I put it in the right order, then R knows, R is smart enough to know that the first letter it has to start, or the first number it has to start from, is 1. It has to end at 9, and it has to increase by 3. It can go to any extent. We can also have have repetitions. I'm not showing you repetitions because we're already very short of time. So I'll just very quickly show you how to make functions, and then we'll talk about maybe vector. I'll talk about the data sets which are there, and then maybe data sets, and then we'll very I'll hand it over to the next speaker. So say, for example, I want to create my own function. Function is, just call it any number, say whatever, SNCW function. I have to have an argument. The argument here is y. And then I have to have a statement that what I want to do with that particular y. So this is how I define my function. This is the function name, this is the argument, and this is the statement. In R, we write statements inside curly brackets. If you remember, I was talking about curly brackets. In Python, for example, we use indentation and all these things. In R, we use curly brackets. So I want to define a function, SNCW function. And how do I define it? I said that I will square root it. This caret means I'm square rooting it. And I subtract 2 out of it. And then say, for example, I want to find out about any particular numbers. SNCW function, it is already showing it to me because it is there. I want to find out about, say, for example, 5. If I square, if I do the square of 5, it will, sorry, it is a square. 5 squared is 25. And if I subtract from, if I subtract 2 from 25, it will be 23. And if I run this function, sorry, it could not find SNCWFN because I did not run this. So I'll have to run this just to show you. If I'm not running this, then R doesn't know where is SNCWFN. So I run this first. Then I run this. And it shows me it is 23. So I have defined SNCW function. What is it? That it will be the square root minus, the squared minus 2. And it is saved there. So as long as I keep working on that, I can recall it as many times as I want. So we have just written our first function, a very simple one indeed. But this is the way in which we have to type in function. If you can see, this is in blue, so this is an inbuilt function. We just write down the argument, which is y, and the statement is that it's squared minus 2. It can be anything. It can be very complex. It can be any number of things. So that's how we get it. Now, very quickly, just let me show you the function as well before we get into simple things about her. Say, for example, I have x is equal to 3, 5, 2, 23, 9. I'll have to write a concatenate function. That's why it is showing me cross. If I don't use C, this means nothing. Now it means it's a vector. I create this vector. This is in the first place. This is known as the first index position. Very important to know about index position. This is the first index position. This is the second index position. This is the third index position. This is the fourth index position. This is the fifth index position. If I want to find out the third number here in x, so what I'll do is I'll type x, then I'll use the box bracket, and then I will write 3. What is the third element here? The third element here is 2. If I run this, I will get 2. So this third bracket is used to, as I said, denote this position or to find out one thing from there. There are many ways in which we can use this index function. I can also use -3 here. If I use -3, then what I'll do is I will not get the third element. I will get each and every element. So I'll get 3, 5, 23, and 9. Just for a moment, you can see that. So I'm accepting this number in the third index position. I'm getting all the other numbers. So very quickly, this is the vector, where these positions are defined by index positions. And I can recall these index positions by using the third bracket. So as you can understand, we've been using the first bracket to define all these, whether we are plotting mean or we are plotting in a curve or we are doing a sequence. When we are writing a function, we're using this curly brackets. And when we are using it for these index positions, we are using this box bracket. Now, I don't have time to talk about, I wanted to show you how matrices are done, but without going there, I'll straightway talk about, data sets which are already present in R and what we can do about that. We were talking about packages. If you can see on the right side of the screen here, these are all the packages. These are the user library. These are the ones that I have added into my work. And if you go down there, this is the system library. This is what the base is. So we are basically using these things. We're using data sets, we're using graphics, we're using, this is by default. If I have to install a package, there are a number of ways in which I can do. One is that I can click here, and if I know the names of whatever, say for example, if there is ggplot2, I can just write ggplot2, and if I install, I'm not going. As you can see, it is showing that there is something called ggplot2. I can install that, or there is tidyr, or there are so many packages that you'll come to know about. So if I want to install that, I'll have to just click over there, install, and it will be installed. Otherwise, there is a code for that also, install packages within inverted commas. That's one thing that has to be done. After you've installed something, you also have to put it in the library here. If you do not, as you remember, if you remember the first part, if I had spoken about that, if you just download and if you do not install it, or if you do not put it in your workspace, then that will not work. There are many ways of working it. Say, for example, if this is tidy select, I want to use it in my library, I will just have to click it, for example, and it will be made available. If I click it, it is already showing me that library tidy select. It is added to my system. This is the console. This is where the actual stuff happens. I want to remove all this place, all these things there. This is taking a lot of my space. I just press Control L, and it is gone. Yeah. So tidy select is if I select any other thing. Say, for example, if I select this tibble, it will be there as it will be there as my library thing. Or I can also do it on my workspace over there, and I can either write either as a library or as a require. I can say require. The moment you just have to type in a few letters, R Studio tells you what you have to. You just write. Tibble is already there, but So is there. Now, whatever arguments or whatever commands that is there inside that package, I can use that. If I'm not adding the package to my library, that will not work. So far, whatever I have worked is in the R base. And we are talking about certain databases. And one celebrated database is the, let me just talk about some of these databases and another just 3 or 4 minutes, right? So say, for example, I want to find out IRIS. Let me talk about Air Miles, which is there. These databases are already there. So I'll have to just, put in. Somebody saying something?
Sir, Ratul Datta is presenting. Can I just request?
Ask him to
present.
Oh my God! Don't remove him, but then.
Ah yes, yes, yes. It's done now.
As it is, there are so many things to talk about, and if you get it disturbed, then let me come back. Where was I? So I have to go through the entire process again. Can you see the screen? Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible. Yes, sir.
The screen I was working on, is it visible?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So Air Miles is a very simple thing. It is just, it is showing, there's just one variable. It is showing, you can see it. This can be, so type in the data set, or say, for example, I want to view the empty cards, for example. So all these data sets are there inside the R base. I just have to use it. I just have to call it, and it is available there. As you can see that, that's why RStudio is such a powerful tool. If I just want to view it, I can just see that, it is talking about these, engines and, the weight and, displacement and the cylinders and all that. So all these are available there. If I want to know about the data sets, there are a number of things I can, do. I can just try and find out about the summary. So one thing that we start off probably is the summary. So I will want the summary of the empty cards that I just showed you. Yeah, let me just bring it up. So all the things that we are seeing, the MPG, so it will, if there are numbers, it will show us the, the minimum value, the first quartile, the median, the mean, and the maximum value. So the entire summary is, provided there. I can also find out the structure of that and find out, what are the variable types there. So I just type str. You don't have to buy hard this, as you work along, you will know about it. So if I just type in str empty cards, so what is empty cards? Empty cards is a data set of all these different cards there. Yeah. So let me just show you that. So it's using everything as a numerical. So it's using this MPG as a number. It's using the number of cylinder as numbers. They are basically categories. So I can change that into categories. There's a way of doing that, but we are running very, very short of time, so I don't want to do that dollar sign thing or whatever. So this is basically a data frame. The difference between a data frame and a matrix is the matrix is of of all similar types of objects. So this is a similar data. This is all number. If I use say for example a character here, everything else will change into character. If I want to find out the type of X now, just if you can see what I show you. It has coerced all these numbers into character. These are no longer numbers here. So this is just a categorical value. This becomes 3. So if I just type in X there, you will get to know. If I just type in X and if I run it, you can see there are these inverted commas there. This is 3, so it's no longer just the number 3, it's a character 3. So the moment I have a value which is not a number and it's a character, R has coerced all the other numbers into characters. It can only have, you know, data of one type. Since it's a vector, it can only have a data of one type. If we have, you know, data of a number of types, it's a list. In matrix also, we generally have a data of one type. In data frames, you know, we have columns. It's just like, you know, the spreadsheet equivalent of R. The columns can have different data types. You know, one of the columns can have. Let me very quickly show you, you know, how to make a you know. So that this is the last thing I'm trying to show you here. But let's say, for example, let's talk about X. Or let's call it name. In fact, it must be there. So let me show you here. Yeah. Okay, it's not there. Okay, so name, let's call it. Character always has to be in inverted commas. As I said, you know, this is one place where we can add in data. Since I was not putting this thing there, it was telling me that it is wrong. It was showing me the, let's say, for example, weight. Let that be about some other thing. Okay, let's write it as. If you can see here, if you see this P here, you know, I've just added three T's here. So this is the logical data that we were talking about. If I just run this, and if I try and find out what is this T of, what is this type of POP, okay. It is logical. So when we have, you know, numbers like T true or false, and it has to be in capital letters. If I was using C, you know, small t, it wouldn't work. Say, for example, I want to create one data frame now. I will run that, so let me run it. Yeah, so if you can just see here, what we've done is we have created a data frame out of these three vectors, name, USP, TG, and AB. If you can understand, these are the three people speaking right now. The weight, USP is 95 kilos, TG is 75 kilos, AB is 65 kilos. Are they popular? Yes, all of them are popular. So what we've done is we have created a data frame. The earlier one that I just showed you was a data frame that existed. So I just recalled that data frame from, you know, the empty car thing that I was talking about. But here we have created this data frame. And if I want to find out what is this type of, it is basically, you will see it is, or you will see that. Is a data frame. We have created a data frame. So before I end and I hand it over to our next speaker, so just very quickly, you know, we showed you how it can work as a you know, giant calculator. You know, it can do logarithmic calculations. We showed you about how this concatenate function is so very important. If we are not using this you know, C function, for example, we won't even get the you know, plots here. If I want to get a plot, or if I want to run it as a vector, I must have this concatenate function. So plot.ts is a very simple time series plot that exists there. There are different ways in which I can assign, you know, to a particular object. So I've assigned 1 to 5. It can be in sequences, it can be in repetitions, it can be, you know, sequences of 1, 3, 5, 9 or whatever. So that those were the type of things that we did. So we also did a sequence where we could, you know, increase by pi levels. I also showed you how to make a function out of you know, you know, available conveniences of this R base here. If we are not using the similar type, R will coerce that into a similar type. So vector, all of them, you know, it has to be either characters or numericals or integers or logicals. If you were having logicals, you know, everything would be converted into numbers. The logical would change into 1 or 0. And then I showed you how to, you know, create a vector out of 3 vectors. You know, I created data frame out of 3 vectors. So I created name, just 3 names, 3 weights, and 3, you know, logical things about popularity. And then I, you know, created a data frame using the command data.frame. I just added the things which I had just defined some time back. So I, you know, just put in the name there. Otherwise, if I don't define it and if I just put in name, it will not work. So I have to tell R that these things are there. Then I told you how to add packages and how to view it here. Then I showed the sets which are increasing, which are present over here. We can view those data frames. We can get a summary of that, and we can also get a structure of that. And we'll find, we can find out, you know, what it consists of. In the example that we saw, we were seeing that they were all numericals. Thank you so much. If there are questions, you know, I would love to come back and, you know, answer these questions. But right now, you know. Due apologies to Dr. Ghosh, because, you know, I took a lot more time than I promised I would. I'm so sorry, Dr. Ghosh. We are all waiting for you.
Well, it's all right. I wish you could have finished the whole thing. Then I would have gotten relief.
No, no. I'm sorry.
It's always challenging to speak after you.
No.
So shall I start, or you would have some?
There'll be a formal introduction, and then you will start.
Okay. Thank you so much, Uma Shankar Pandey sir, for your nice, enlightening insights about R. Now I would like to invite, and I'll take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Tirthankar Ghosh. As I mentioned earlier, he is Assistant Professor, Stage 3, Department of Statistics, Shiksha Bhavan, Vishwa Bharati University, Shantiniketan. He has been a Research Associate, Department of Earth, Ocean and Atmospheric Science, Florida State University, USA. Dr. Ghosh's research interest includes reliability and probability distribution theory, time series analysis, data analysis, visual analytics, and applications of statistics in weather and climate. His works have been published in many journals of national and international repute. So it's my immense pleasure to invite Dr. Tirthankar Ghosh on this digital platform. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bhattacharya, for your kind introduction. So I would not further delay in the particular topic, but I can tell you at the beginning is that R is definitely is a very powerful tool to work with. It doesn't depend to any of the particular discipline like statistics or something else. It can be used by anybody, and it should be used because it is open source and it has a tremendous potential. But encapsulating everything within 1.5 hours or maybe in a single day is very difficult and challenging. And I'm not sure how much I can make justice to the audience that that what you are expecting and how I can, how much I can deliver. But looking at the chat box when Dr. Pandey's talk was going on, I feel that I should jump into the data first and then I can come back to the basics what Dr. Pandey was discussing. Because most of the time I found that some people was trying to associate that why we should learn R or something like that, or how to associate R with your research work or something like that. So now can you see my screen? Just give me a confirmation by typing. Typing Y, because okay. Just when I ask anything, just type Y if you for confirmation. Okay. So very at the very beginning, I would just like to come to one slide very quickly, though it is not may not be very convenient for you to understand, but. See, why do we talk about R, or why do we deal with data? Because I think this great man has said that, why do we do that? In God we trust, all others must bring data. Because nobody is going to trust you until you have a valid data behind your claim, what you are making. So basically what we do when we do a research, we have a hypothesis mainly, and then we collect some data and information, and then we put the data into some logical way to analyze them, and then we claim that this is our hypothesis and this is true or this is false or something like that. Now I am not going to details of these, but you know, now probably all of us know that now business are being run on data or analyzing data. It's no more business minds only. Definitely business minds are there. But we are all habituated with this type of experiences. As soon as we buy something online, we get some recommendations automatically. Now, suppose you bought one mobile phone online and you get immediately one recommendation by the company or e-commerce giant from where you are buying, that 90% of the persons who bought this set, they also bought these handsets or these cover and something like that. So how do they immediately generate that much information, and how do they recommend it? So this is totally based on data, and that is called recommendation engine, and wholly driven and developed by the data. Or so using this, just one statistics of last year is Amazon generates 35% of its revenue just using automatic recommendation. So advertisements we used to see in television, you all are media persons, so you know better than me. But now automatically using this recommendation engines also, companies are generating revenue. So those are really very important to know the data and how we can use it. So some of you were discussing that how to relate this R and things like that with your research or anything what you do. For that, we need to understand the life cycle of data. The first term is the data collection, and we do it in multiple ways, we know that. The second term is very much important, this scrutiny and cleansing the data. Because it's as simple as that, like when you go to the market in the morning and we bring some vegetables and we don't put those vegetables into the pan immediately after bringing them from the market. We just literally scrutinize them, what is to be taken, what is not to be taken, what is to be cleaned, what is not to be cleaned. We need to do that. So for any type of data, no matter what type of work you are doing, you have to do that first. And that can be also given an analogy, like suppose in your in this summer vacation, or sometimes you've been to your native place and it's a scorching hot day and you found a nice cool pond, and will you jump on it very quickly as soon as you see that pond? No, because you need to know whether it is, how much deep the pond is, whether it is safe to be in the pond to take bath and things like that. So that's a scrutiny and cleansing is very much important, and those things are also you can do in R. That's what my first take on the relationship between this. And then as soon as we found that, okay, this much data I can take for the analysis what we are going to do, and then we start
our preliminary work. And in that preliminary work, we start with some basic visualizations and then EDA, exploratory data analysis. So those are the things like we do, and we'll be maybe doing some of the stuff from real life data, I mean, one real data. So from that, we would have one idea that what should be the next course of action, right? And then we will analyze the data in more depth, and then probably we'll be developing some model building. Now, what type of model we need to build, we'll come to that in the next slide maybe. So the next part is model building, and then one example is that like finding the correlation and then regression equation. Sometimes we do cluster analysis, sometimes we do classification. Like cluster analysis, I can give you one example as we spoke about this Amazon thing. So there is a thing is called customer segmentation. In any shopping mall or any big retail store, there are different segments, like say apparels, like garments, then groceries, and then say cosmetics, then many things like that. And then what they do is, out of the customer pool, they segment them. They segmentize them that, okay, who are buying what type of thing. Most of the time, it is not like that you are going to a shopping mall and you are buying all of your necessities from the same mall only. Maybe you are buying apparels from that particular shop. Maybe you are going to the next and you are buying, say, groceries from that. So what they do is, they, using that segmentation, they promote business accordingly. Like if you are the grocery buyer from that particular shop, so they will be sending the promotional codes only for grocery items to you, because they know that this person actually buys groceries from mine, because they will not be sending the apparel promotions to you, because they know that you are not going to buy apparels from their shop. And if they send you the promotional scheme, that is their loss. So that's why customer segmentation is very much important. And that's where cluster analysis comes in. Classification also, one similar example I can give you is that there are many examples can be given. Basically, it is kind of, suppose you know that how many classes are there in the population. And then on the basis of the data, you are optimally designing one rule how to classify this. Okay, if this happens, then he will be belonging to that particular category. If that happens, then they will be belonging to that particular category. So things like that. I'm just talking about only marketing, but there are many other things. I mean, medical science also, classification takes a very huge role. Like any kind of image is being diagnosed as a kind of, say, malignant or not. I'm talking about some. So things like that, this type of classifications, and those things are very much important. So those comes under the word modeling. So there are many stuff we do. We'll come to that. Now, once you develop your model, you had the data, and then you need to interpret your results. Very, very important. Because you know what happens is, no matter what discipline you are from, you have to understand your problem, and then you have to formulate your problem and do whatever statistical analysis you are performing, and then you have to interpret it properly. It's not that you have an SPSS or you have an kind of R, or you have some sort of tool to analyze the data, and you get something and you do the analysis and you write something which you don't know what you are writing all about. So that's what you need to know very well. So it is, I always try to give an example, like when we are driving, we at least need to know how to drive the car. Otherwise, we will end up with an accident. So it is just like that. You put the data into your SPSS, you get the result, and you are writing something which does not come to any sort of logical explanation, and that doesn't have any meaning. So a meaningful interpretation is very much important. And for that, you no need to learn in-depth statistics, but you need to learn what is it and where we can use it. This much statistical basic knowledge you need to have, or any kind of data analysis type. So that's why interpretation is very much important, where you should put your concentration on. And then you get the final product. Like, as I said, being a kind of data analyst or data scientist, one company gave me to segment his customers, and I gave the segmentation. Okay, then the manager will take care of it, that the segmentation they got, and then they will be sending the kind of promotional SMSs or promotional schemes to them. Or I designed the classification rule, and after that they will be using that classification rule for their future purposes. So that is the final product or the from the data, and then we use it. And again, you can go for collecting data to enhance your previous data pool, so that you get much updated statistical model, and you can go ahead. So that's how basically we need to understand. And then this is very common to you. We can use Python, R, SPSS, Tableau, and many things like that. I don't want to go to much detail of this. And now, types of data, if you talk about structured data, mostly we can tell that what type of data we can put in row column fashion, that is a structured data. Like we can put the data into Excel sheet, like age, name, income of 100,000 people, we can put in the structured data. Unstructured data, it's very important nowadays. It is very, very, very common, especially in your case, in media studies and all those. Here, everything is a data. Now, social media is a very, very important source of data. You are putting one image of something, somebody is liking, somebody is giving one emoji, somebody is writing something, somebody is reacting in a different way. All reactions are not same. And personally, we all know who is reacting in which type of mode, or which type of closeness we have with that particular person. So all we now take as data, like audio, video, anything. So that's why this thing also, we now talk about now unstructured data, like as I just mentioned. And then, so mainly we will concentrate on structured data, or we will be operating on structured data, at least for this particular discussion. Now, this is very important, what I am going to explain now. And I am sure that you can relate this with your research work. Whatever data you have, suppose you got it and it is being cleansed and scrutinized, everything is fine. Now it is the hard work, or it is the work or hardcore work what you are going to do. First of all, we need to go for a descriptive study. What does it mean? It means we have to understand what has happened. Descriptive statistics means it gives you the history of that particular thing what you are studying. Okay, what has happened? Like say you have an interest on literacy rate of India. So what you do, you would collect some data and then you will calculate the literacy rate in the data you have. That is one type of study we do in our research. Predictive study. That means what would happen? This much may be of our interest, and we collected data for that. We made some descriptive study out of it, and then we have to develop one, either regression or logistic regression or something else to predict the situation. I can tell you one more. Anyway, we'll, I think you can see the examples as well, very common examples. Prescriptive, this is very important one. What should be done for improvement? This is normally one example many people gives from telecom sector, that probably all of us, we know that we get some promotional messages from the companies that only you have, for you, this exclusive offer is there. You pay 200 rupees, you will get this much data free, this much messages free, and so on. So why do they give you so special attention? Do you know what is the reason behind that? This comes from a very interesting problem of telecom sector. It's called churning, churn. Churning means now portable number portability is there, and then people moves away from one company to another company because they don't care about the number. Number is always there, the same number. And then it is a challenging for the companies to retain their customers. Now, what do they do is looking back to your behavior over the last 6 months or 1 year, how much calls do you make? How much internet do you use? How much, which facility you use? They do one analysis and they compute the probability that you are going to charge them. That means you are going to change the company. What is that probability? And if that probability is say more than 0.5, then they will try to retain you and they will give you some offers. Hey, you stay with us, we'll give you. They are not saying that you stay with us. Momentarily, when you are thinking that, okay, I'll go to that particular that company for my mobile. And then as soon as you get some new offers for you from your old company, you are sticking to them. So from where do they get those type of prescription? The data science scientists, what they do is from the data, they tell to the company that, okay, this particular guy is going to charm you with this probability. Now, when they know the probability that it is very high, then they give you the promotional offer. So that is how this prescriptive studies are very important. Inferential, this is very common term, inference, examining a statement or approximate a value of a particular characteristic. That is, we generally known as testing or estimation. So like as I said, we do hypothesis testing. So this is also one important task we need to do after collecting the data. Another thing I added that is called probability is not properly visible. I'm sorry about that. I would like to request my viewers just to look at this. Anomaly detection, is it weird? This is the question. Probably many of you have credit cards and many of you do international purchasing. Now, as soon as you do one first international purchase, immediately you would get one call from the credit card company that, is that order made by you? I'm sure many of you have had this experience. And then you said, yeah, I did that. And then they give the green signal, okay, pay for that company. So this actually called anomaly detection. Whenever something is not normal, that is called anomaly. And that anomaly detection, checking a spam email into your box. How do they do that? How Google thinks that this could be a spam email? By looking at the words it has been used. The lottery, big money you are going to get, something like that will be there in that mail. So that also is being kind of modeled using statistical stuff, and R is very much there. We can show you. I'm not sure whether it is possible today or not, but we can show you that these all four or five things what I just meant can be done using R. Very interestingly, like I had one experience just like that last week. Last week we had a 7 days long workshop on online learning and teaching. So there I was in a position of managing the thing. And there I was sending a bulk emails from our G Suite email. Suddenly after 2-3 occasions, I found that my email got disabled. And they told me, you contact your system admin. And I contacted him and then he told me that they found that this particular account does not do this type of bulk emailing. So since that it is doing, something is wrong or something is not natural. So their administrator should know that. That's why they disabled your account so that you come to me and I can interrogate you that what have you done? And if something is to be corrected, I can do that. And that's how things can be in proper place. So this anomaly detection is very, very important. So that's how you can be assured that all of these four or five tasks you can do, no matter which domain you are from, even in media studies also, I think you can and apply any one of these studies very, very well. So I am just going to give you some more statistical insights. Probably you have it. I'm apologizing if I am just overriding your senses. But anyway, so we have to understand when we are doing any kind of numerical or data analysis thing, that what are the types of variables, or what are the types of the characters rather. So by variable, we normally mean quantitative character, which we can express in terms of numbers. And by attribute, we normally refer to qualitative character. How did you like the movie? Good, bad, worse, very good, okay. Sometimes we do it, say it as ordinal data. What is your level of education? This is also, we can tell primary, secondary, university. Sometimes this level of education can also be expressed in terms of number also. How many years did you spend in the school? 10 years, 15 years, and so on. So similar to that. So just we need to know those type of things, types of qualitative characters. You know all these, I'm just giving a refreshing knowledge, just gender, male, female, and you can write others also. Hair color, these are ordinal nominal data. This is actually qualitative characters. And the qualitative characters could also be ordinal, like where there will be a natural order, excellent, very good, good. Sometimes we get come across to rate this type of, immediately after this meeting will be over, we have to give a rating to the Google, right? So that's how they do the analysis every time. Continuous data also, I mean, variables are also two types, continuous and discrete, like weight of a person, height of a gate, length of a bridge, all are continuous. I mean, continuous means the variable can take any value within its specified range. And discrete means the variable takes its value within some discrete values within its range, number of members in a family and so on. So I'm not putting these things on, because I think you may be waiting for going to this R thing. So before I go to directly jump onto the R, how to do that, I'm just quickly showing you that what R can do very interestingly, so that you get attracted to R. Okay, believe me, I'm not going to teach you whole R in a single 1 hour lecture, but I can tell you, I'm trying to attract your attention towards R so that you get attracted to learn R. So as Dr. Pandey has said, that you have to use many libraries. Now you may get into confusion that what is a library? Forget about everything. Libraries are nothing but it's a bunch of works already been done there. You are going to use it. You no need to get into this much. Just so there is one library called ggplot, which is being used for nice plotting. I'll just show you one example. So for whenever we are using any library, we have to first type this install.packages, and then okay, we'll come to that afterwards. So library ggplot2 I am using, and then what I am doing is this is okay, this is the way we have to use or install a package. Packages again, it's a bunch of codes in written in R for a specific purpose. Somebody has written it, you are just going to use it. That's it. Like we download some apps from the for our mobile. We don't know what is going on there, but we know that if we download this app, we are going to get this work done. Just like that. So Gapminder is also one package. There are many packages, more than 10,000 packages are there. And you will be knowing eventually what package you need to use. Don't worry on that what package and how to. So if you know which package you are going to use, you have to use this particular code, install.packages, then within double quote and within bracket, you have to write the name of the package, right? And then just don't forget, as Dr. Pandey has mentioned, that R is a case sensitive language. Most of the things are written in small or lowercase letter. So don't forget that. So since I have installed this package, I'm not going to install it. But after you install it, to make it act, you have to run this library. I already have done it few minutes back. That's why I am done. So first you install, like when we download some package in our computer, it gets downloaded in the download folder, then we have to run the setup to get it installed in the computer to make it work. Just like that, we have to run this code every time you are going to use this, like that. Now I am going to use this, and now this is actually one data, right? So this is, I am running the code. Okay, by the way, I can tell you one thing, is that I am not using RStudio right now. Actually, I will be showing it. I am using Anaconda Navigator. This is another R editor, you can say, where you can work in R as well as Python. Though in RStudio also you can work in R and Python both, but I find this Anaconda Navigator is much better to at least for the presentation. So see, I am running as well as you can see, this is in presentation mode. I'll tell about this afterwards. But anyway, so Gapminder is a kind of data, country name, continent, year, life expectancy, population, and GDP per capita. Those are being listed here in this data, in this Gapminder. Okay, now I'm just going to quickly show you how beautiful it is. So ggplot is a package for plotting, nice plotting. As I said, plotting gives us much insights of the data, right? So we need to learn very nice plotting. I can go for basic plotting also very quickly, but so when you run this, don't need to follow the code, but you just try to understand what R can do, right? So I am running this code. What is Gapminder? So I am going to plot this particular data. AES means aesthetics, and then X is one direction or horizontal axis, Y is life expectancy. So we are going to plot GDP per capita in the horizontal axis and life expectancy in the vertical axis. So this is how it shows, right? And now if I just run this line of code, the same thing, ggplot, gapminder, the same thing, plus GOM means point. That means we are telling to the machine by R that you put only the points. That is, it's a two-dimensional plane. If you think that I need to show it in a smaller version, then this is the, okay. You see, this is the GDP per capita and this is life expectancy. So this is for all the countries. You can understand this, that how it can be shown. And now we are just, again, we are naming the whole code as P, right? No need to follow it. You just try to understand that what is being done in R. The whole code we are putting as P, and then again we are writing here, the code is becoming smaller. So that is also how you can make your code very small. So now the P means the whole thing, what we written here is already written there, and then GM equal to point. And now when I'm running this line of code, we are getting the same plot what we just showed few minutes back. Now, as I showed from mathematical point of view, that it is very difficult to interpret the data and what we need to do. So from mathematical idea, we can tell that we need to take some transformation of the data. And when you take log transformation of the data, it doesn't change the nature of the data, but it scales it down in a different way. So what we did is, we did nothing. Earlier we were putting only the GDP per capita, but now we are putting in the horizontal axis logarithm with base 10. You can put natural logarithm as well. Logarithm base 10 of the GDP per capita. And then we get a nice plot. Let me put it in a smaller window. Right? So you got this. So now you can see, we can get a kind of linear trend. That means when GDP per capita is more, life expectancy is more. You may say that it is very common. When a country is richer, the life expectancy will be richer. But the point is, how can you come to that conclusion until you have this type of data? When you have this type of data and you have this type of plot, you can come to a conclusion like that. And I would say that is not a conclusion. By putting the plot, we get an idea, and then you need to you need to run the regression equation and you need to check whether the regression coefficients are significant or not. And what is called significant, I am going to explain you maybe if I have the time. And then when that regression equation is significant, then you can claim that as far as the data is concerned, we can tell that when GDP, per capita GDP increases, life expectancy also increases, right? So we get that what type of analysis we can do from this plot, right? Now, moving forward. So this is again, we are just scaling it down. That's nothing new. And then this is one fantastic plot you can see. The whole data set, what we earlier plot, we had only black dots. And now what we have is, we have the dots according to its continent. And now you can see, let me put the data. I'm sorry, the window is not that big. So now you can see that all African countries thing is like, is quite smaller. The life expectancy is quite smaller, as well as their GDP is also smaller. Similarly, you can see this kind of blue thing. It is Europe here, GDP per capita income is also this much, and life expectancy is also high. So just by plotting a simple scatter plot, you can get much insight out of the data, and which is nothing but we just added different colors for different continents. I think you got now what I am trying to mean. Now, how to do that? You can understand or you can learn little more, I mean, after some time. So this is again what we are going to do. We are just changing the plot pattern, the size of the dots we are increasing here, the size of the dots we increase. Here again, taking the whole data set, we are trying to make a mathematical model, and that is how it will look like. So this is again, we are just making the line bigger and thicker and stuff like that. If we try to make it a linear regression, then how it will look. And you can understand that by looking at this plot, that if we go with the linear regression for this data point, this will not be a good fit, right? So that is how you can at least understand that how interestingly we can make things happen in R. Now here again also we made different regression lines or different curves for different continents, right? So this is again just to show you how you can relate your study with the R. Now coming to basic thing, since I don't have much time, I already crossed my limit probably. So just to give you some basic insights of how we can make it, like Professor Pandey has said, a vector. Vector is nothing but in R, there are different types of data, I would say data types, right, rather. So scalar, which contains only one variable, one observation, not one observation, one dimensional observation. And then vector, it has one dimension. In scalar is one particular quantity. And then matrix, it contains two way, row and column. And then you can get data frame, just to shorten the thing. What is a data frame? Data frame is something which contains the data in row and column, where you can have both qualitative as well as quantitative data. In matrix, you also have two-way layout data, but all the data are numbers. Matrix, all the data are numbered, but in data frame, you will have all types of data, like first row could be age, second row could be gender, third row could be income, fourth row could be something else, left-handedness or right-handedness, something like that. So just like that. So this is also very important to know, and I'm not sure whether I have that much time to discuss that particular thing. There is another thing is called list. List actually accommodates all types of data in R. List can contain a scalar, list can contain a vector, list can contain a matrix, list can contain a data frame. Let me show you if I have it. Just a second, because this is very, so these are some fundamental things we should know, but anyway, just to come along with the plotting, I can tell you that let's say we have some values 1, 2, 3, 4, like say income of 4 families, then we are giving those into a vector C and we are writing those as a variable X, then we are putting this into X and then we are plotting pi X. This is as simple as that. Don't think that R is difficult because you have to write the code. No, it is not. Just keep in mind that you can do beautiful stuff with 100% confidence, and you will have ample help, community help, as well as help in the package itself. And it is open source. That's the best thing. SPSS many people use this, but they don't have the proper version, and that I don't recommend to use. Anyway, so you see, I just ran this line of code, and we have 4 slices, and the shares they have written. Now, if you want to give the levels of 4 slices like Kerala, Bihar, UP, and West Bengal, so we gave it's an object levels. Now we run it, and then we are drawing the pie chart again for the data set X with the level X. Now you can see the levels, you can get it. Kerala, West Bengal, Bihar, UP, right? So that is how you can beautifully do this. Now you wish to add some title into this. So gradually you are making it complex. So you are starting with a simpler plot, and then you can make it little.
Has he left the meeting? Is there some network issue, I guess?
Complex. Earlier we did.
So he's Dr. Ghosh is rejoining, so he'll just be coming back. Yeah, he's back. It's muted, sir. You have to unmute.
Yeah, now am I audible?
Yeah, you are, sir.
Yeah, I'm sorry that I didn't know I got disconnected. Anyway. So, is my screen visible? Just, okay, thank you. So what I was telling is that we are going to make this plot little complex at each step. Earlier we had only the slices, then we added the levels, and then we added the title. And in R, all plots will be titled just like this, comma, and then main equals to, and within quote you have to write the title of the plot, whatever you do, not only in pi.
pie chart everywhere. And then this is how we do that. But let's say you are not satisfied with the color, and then you can change the color also, like pie, X, levels, main, nothing is changed up to this. Then we just added this line extra, color equal to rainbow, and then length equal to X. Length equal to X, this is also one important thing, that is actually length of the vector, that is how many components are there in the vector. I'm sorry I did not show all this, probably some of those has been shown by Dr. Pandey. So length of X means how many colors it will take from the rainbow. We said as many length is the of the levels. Levels are 4, that's why it has taken, and I am running it in real time, and this is the plot, it takes the change. So that is how you can take some other type of So this is, again, if we wish to, like in our studio also, in Jupyter Notebook, here this is the run button. And then here one interesting thing is, you can write as well as you can generate one cell to interpret the results. That is one beautiful thing which we then don't have in R, where we do it using the hash sign. So here in this cell number 9, what did we do? We just up to this it is fine. Then we are adding the legend, right? Legend, position of the legend, top right, and the position is written in the double quote. And then C, Kerala, West Bengal, Bihar, UP, and fill equal to rainbow length X, because we have used rainbow length X in the pie chart, original pie chart. So that's why. So that is actually, we get this pie chart done fully. If you not only that, here in the cell number 8, we have computed the percentages as well. Let me run this once more. So we have, earlier we had the numbers, now we had computed the percentages, and then we can give the title, and then the percentage values, and then the legend as well. So that's how you can do this. And as soon as now, whenever we fill out a form in Google form, and then we see this comes very quickly. But they are running some sort of code like this in behind the scene. Similarly, bar plots are also very common. And now let me tell you one thing, that when do we do bar plot and when do we do pie chart? So that thing is also very important to note, that bar plot and all those things, basically for count data, we need to use that. For count data means, say, number of accidents. Say, suppose we have, say, 4 traffic points in Kolkata, right? 4 busy traffic points. And then you are taking the statistics of number of accidents happened in those 4 traffic points in last 1 month. So this is own data, and there you can see that bar chart and pie chart can be used. So this is also very important to note, that what type of plot or what type of visual analytics we should use in depicting our data in a meaningful way. So that's why you have to have that insight, that which one is count data, which one is a continuous variable, which one is not, which one is ordinal, and so on. So that much is very important. So bar plot is very common. See, the basic thing what we do in R is very common. See, bar plot, it's very common to remember bar plot, and within bracket with the name of the vector. Earlier we wrote that, and we get this, and so on. And then again, if we need to change the direction, that is, here it is vertical, here it is horizontal, right? So bar plot X horizon equal to T. You may think that, oh my God, how can I going to remember this horizon equal to T? Don't worry, eventually after a few days, you will be very accustomed with this type of words. No need to worry on that. As I said, a data frame, see, this is a data frame. It contains the levels as well as the values, numerical values. So here A is a data frame. So we are writing A as a data frame, right? Now, let me go back. So this is again, this is another type of way how you can do the bar plot, then X along with the labels. You see the data here, X and data. So here, earlier we did the bar plot in a different way. Now we are doing bar plot in a different way. Bar plot, and then now you may get confused with this dollar sign. In R, whatever we take as a data frame is nothing but is the data set. Now somebody was asking how to put the data into R. I'm going to show it in 1 minute. Don't worry. So you can type it in this way also. You can type it in this way also, but when the data is a longer one, when the data contains a huge number of observations, how you are going to type it? Mostly we get the data in Excel format, in CSV format. How can we get that into R? So don't worry, using CSV format data, we can put the data directly into R and we can denote that data as a data frame. Now, when you have a data frame, namely A, capital A, then what we are doing is A dollar sign and X. X is a variable in the data frame, right? Then, so here actually we are isolating the variable X of the data frame A using this dollar sign. So in any data frame, whenever you need to isolate a variable or a column, you have to use first the name of the data frame, then use the dollar sign, and then the column you wish to, sorry, it got changed, then you wish to isolate. And this tilde is kind of on, like regression equation of y on x, something like that. So we are plotting x on the labels of the data frame A. So when you do that, you get this type of, okay, maybe we did not, I did not run this cell probably. Probably I did not run this cell. Now it should work. Yeah, so don't worry. Sometimes you might get some error messages, but the hint will be there in the error message. So that is also one important thing. Don't worry on that. So that is how, again, you can add the title like this, as I just showed few minutes back, main and equal to, and then bar plots of accident data. And then say you wish to add the titles in the horizontal axis as well as vertical axis. So X lab is a technical term in R, which says that what will be the title of the X axis. So X level of the X axis. So that is written in short form X lab. Similarly, Y lab is level of the Y axis. So here we are writing in the Y axis accidents, and in the X axis we are writing states. So just by looking at this, you can say this is the state UP where the accidents are more. So this is not a real data. We are just taking one example. Now we came to a point where we are showing how can you input a data into R. Okay, let me show you one data set. This is a data which is one dummy data set. Gender, age, income, and score, some sort of score. Age is quantitative, income is quantitative, score is also quantitative. Now I'm going to particular shopping data, yeah, this one. Now what I'm going to do, I am going to right click, take the properties and copy the path, right? Dr. Pandey has shown that we need to set a working directory. Yeah, that is a good habit. If you don't worry. You can do like that also, because mostly we need to do is we need to take the data only once, and then we'll be doing the work, and then we'll be delivering the results into some reports. So if you can set the working directory, that will be really nice. But if you don't, if you cannot, don't worry. So what I did, I have the data saved in this particular folder in CSV format, okay? And then I right click, went to the properties, and I click the path. And there is one some interesting state what we did. Now what I'm going to do is, though I have already written it, but let me do it here. So I have to give name of a data frame, right? Earlier we gave A, now we are giving here shop data. Let's say I'm giving S1 and then read dot, sorry. Let me tell you one more thing. What is this less than and then dash? Or less than and then minus? This is called assignment operator. Assignment operator means S1 is assigned these particular thing. You can use equal to also. If you are confused that, okay, this is two particular button I have to press, why don't we use one? You can do that. So read.csv and then why read.csv? Because I have saved the data in CSV format. If I had, I would have saved the data in say tab delimited tab version, then I could have written read.table, read.tab. Okay, so read.csv, then I am going to click double quote and then I am going to paste the whole path what I just copied. One interesting thing I need to do here, I need to change all these backward slashes into forward slashes. If you look at my previous line, you can relate it with that, right? And then you need to give the name. Again, you go to the properties and you take the copy the name. And I would request not to read and write. I request to copy it. Because in that case, CSV. And now you can write header equal to true. H-E-A-D-E-R. Header equal to true, or you can write header equal to false. Now, what does this header do? You see in my data file, the first row are the names of these columns. Those are known, not the data. So header equal to true means it is telling R that the first row is name of the columns. So by default, actually, if you don't give this, then nowadays there is no problem. Earlier we had to use this, obviously, otherwise it would have thrown one error. But nowadays header equal to true is by default R takes it. So if you don't forget, if you forget it, no worries. But just to be safe or just to keep your habit on, you can write header equal to true. I normally do that, but I am not saying that this is mandatory. Header H-E-A-D-E-R equal to true. Now I'm just deleting this because I don't want to get goofed up. Now I'm running this, okay? Now I'm running this line of code. So it took the line. It took the line. That means when you run one line of code and it doesn't throw any error, that means your code is perfect. Okay, let me run this line of code. Let me copy it and let me run this line of code into RStudio as well, because many of you might be thinking that why I'm not writing in RStudio. Let me do this. So shop data read.csv, and then what I did, and now I'm running this. So see, there in this R kernel, there is no error, right? There is no error. So that means I am fine. Now, if I wish to view the data, V-I-E-W, view the data, then you have to type view and then S-H-O-P, yeah, shop data. RStudio gives you hint. Now I am clicking. I should have written it here because otherwise I am going to lose this once more. Yeah, so See, we have the whole data set. We have the whole data set. You can remember that we had only 16 observations. Now, if we go here, we can see that 16 observations are there. I mean, 16 lines are there, including this, right? So that is how you can see the data set in our studio. But in Anaconda Navigator, one more thing I would like to point out here is that this particular view, you see this B is capital. This B is capital. So don't think that B will be small. This is one a kind of different line you have to remember, but this is also one specific function in R, view. View means viewing any data frame, you have to type view, V-I-E-W, and V will be capital. But one thing here I was telling in the Anaconda Navigator is that view button doesn't, view code doesn't work in Anaconda, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to view the whole data set. What I can do, I can tell R that, okay, show me 8 rows or show me say 10 rows of the data set. So the code is very simple, head and name of the data frame and N. N means number of lines. I wish to see 10 lines. So let me run it. See, I got the 10 lines. Now, if you just wish to see the data set, the 10th observation here, male 30, 1972. See, male 30, 1972. So it's all right. Okay. So at least we got the data into our R. Somebody has this question. I hope you can now bring it into R. So what you are doing, you are taking the data in the Excel, in CSV format, you are saving it, and then you are giving a name of the data file, a name whatever you wish to, then read.csv within bracket, first you have to give the whole path, then name of the file. And while you are giving the path, that time you have to use the forward slash. That is the thing. You might think that, okay, these are many steps you are describing. No, you do once, twice, thrice, then you will be very habituated in that. So this is one step you can start working with. Then let's say in the data set, as I said, you have to scrutinize the data. Means, let's say I wish to check whether there is any, okay, so this one came. So what we are doing here is we are plotting the gender. We had, let me put it in a smaller version. So we had two genders in the data set. So we just got it male and female. See the simple form of the code. Plot and then shop data dollar sign gender. Because as I said few minutes back, that if you wish to isolate what particular variable in the data frame or in the data set, you have to give the name of the data frame, then dollar sign and name of the variable. So basically in this line, what we are doing, we have already written here is that plots the frequencies of each category of the variable. Each category means gender is a categorical variable here, then it is plotting. Now, some of you might ask that how did you know that it is a categorical variable? That's a very important question. Let me show you it here. So what I'm going to do is structure and then shop data. Dr. Umashankar has already mentioned structure. Structure means it describes the nature of each of the variables in the data set. Now let me come to here. See, when I did str shop data, what did it do? It showed us that shop data is a data frame. It has 15 observations on 5 variables. ID is an integer type, gender is a factor, it has 2 levels, male and female, and then age is an integer, these are the values, income in integer, score is integer. Now as I said that gender is factor or qualitative, so I wished to get the plot and I got it. So looking at this plot, I can say there are more females than the males, right? Now again we are plotting it horizontally, so here I did the same thing, but only one thing added is horiz.t. We got it male, female. So we could change the color. That is also one important thing. Maybe some of you might be thinking that how did we change the color? So we shared that, showed that in case of pie chart, but here we are using only red. So this is the only code, COL, COL and equal to sign, and then within double quote, red. If I just change it to blue, let me change it. See, it got blue, right? So that's how you can make your things really interesting. Now, let's say you want to know the names of the variables in the data frame. Names of the variable in the data frame, very simple code, names, and within bracket or within bracket, you have to write the name of the data frame. This shows, the names of the variables in the data frame. Okay, so when I run this line of code, what we get is, we get that there are five variables, ID, gender, age, income, and score. Now, what we are doing is, some of you are very accustomed with the box plot. Let's say we are doing box plot of age. I need to again shorten this. So we are doing box plot and we got this one. So we see these are the outliers and this is the median, maximum and minimum. So from this also you can have some interpretation of the data, and that comes under the exploratory data analysis. So you can very much start working immediately after importing the data, that some basic descriptive statistics, that what has happened, what is the nature. Like this is the variable age. So median age is 30, though we have some three observations which are of quite high age. That means you can say. Now again, the since we can plot it horizontally as well. Let me run it and show it once more. So horizontally, what we did, box plot, shop data. Again, we isolated it using the name of the data frame, the dollar sign, and then name of the variable. Color, red, X lab means level of the X axis, age in years. Horizontal equal to true, T means true. You can write the whole thing T-R-U-E. And then main equal to box plot of age. So this is the title and this is the color. And that's how you can get it. Now we can see the histogram as well. I'm sorry, in this window, things are getting cut because, okay, histogram, it's very simple, H-I-S-T, hist, and then which variable you are going to get the histogram of. So I have written the what this line of code does. So this is one good way of writing code. This is called documentation of the code. Like most of the time, if you just look at this, if you don't know what is this, then it will be very difficult to understand what is going on. But if you give a comment on this, and commenting happens in R after starting this dollar hash sign, then it will be very easier to understand. So this is how we plotted the age, histogram of the variable age. Here is, we did the same thing, but we have also introduced that color. And now if we wish to get the density, then what we did, we have just isolated the variable as G. Here, as we isolated the variable P for the plotting in Gapminder, here we have isolated with the variable G, shop data and dollar sign age. Now G means it will take the variable age from the shop data. Now it is, then the next line is plotting what type, density plot, means what type of density it can follow, and then color is red. So that is how we can see, we can interpret it as a bimodal thing. One mode is here at the age 20, another mode is here. And if you remove those outliers, then you may get one unimodal thing and interpreting will happen accordingly. Okay, one more thing I would like to discuss and then I'm going to stop. Let's say we have two variables, X and Y. Some observations on X, some observations on Y. Okay, now we are plotting X and Y. You see, you get this plot. This is called basically, basically the scatter plot. x in the horizontal axis and y in the vertical axis. And then if we wish to change the color of the dots, and also we added the title. So plot x comma y means main equal to within quote scatter plot of x comma y and then comma color equal to red. We are running this line of code. We got this. Let me change it to blue, blue. Let's see what do we get. See, we got the blue, right? So that is how you can similarly add the x level, y level, and so on. Probably we did not do that part. Again, let's say we wish to get the correlation coefficient. See how simple is this. COR, let me make it bigger. Oh, actually that got hidden in the next line because I forgot to segment it. Anyway, so the correlation is, if you can see, I'm sorry that I cannot make it bigger. See, correlation is very simple. COR, let me add one cell here. okay, anyway, so I think it is visible. COR, only COR and within bracket x comma y means we need to know the value of the product moment correlation coefficient between x and y. So as soon as we type it and enter or run it, we get 0.9777. That means a very high correlation. And then immediately we may be interested in going to get the regression equation of y on x, since we are running behind the time. So what we are doing, we are defining an object reg, and then we are putting one assignment operator. We can put equal to as well. Then lm means linear model, because we are setting here linear regression equation. We can use glm also, but now we are not discussing this part. So lm, and then y tilde x. Tilde means you can get this sign immediately after just below the escape button of your keypad. Probably you got this tilde. So y on x, right? Now if we run this, then it did not throw any error. That means the regression line is done. Now I am going to do summary of regression. Means summary of regression means, as I was saying, that we found that there could be some relationship, but is that relationship, what is the mathematical form of that relationship? Though we say it is y equals a plus bx, then what is the form of, what is the value of a and what is the value of b? That is the first question. So that question is being estimated, being given here. Estimated intercept is this minus 38.45509, and the b, that is the intercept, slope is 0.6746. So this is, we got our y equal to a plus bx. So a is this, b is this. Now the question is, are these significant? Means that I'm not sure whether it will be difficult for you to understand, but just keep in mind that what result we got, is it going to change if we change a different sample? If we change the sample, means probability of this value will be zero. This value means intercept value will be zero when this data set is there. That probability is 0.001, means it is very low. And this is also, so a equal to zero, b equal to zero, under this hypothesis, probability of getting this particular data set is very low. In case of a, the probability is 0.001. In case of b, it is way small. That means when b is zero, a is zero in the true sense, then we are not going to get this particular regression equation. That means this regression equation is very much significant. We cannot ignore this relationship. So there are other parameters also where we can look at, like this multiple R square means 0.95 means this regression equation is going to explain 95% values of y on the basis of x, right? So or it is going to explain the variability in y using the value of x in 95% cases. So that is also one interesting feature to look at. If this value is very lower than 0.5, we are not in a position to accept that regressional equation is a very good one. Similarly, if you go for the F statistic, some of you must have gone with the ANOVA and all those things. Maybe if we have some time in near future, we can discuss those. But this value is also shows that the p-value is quite low. Means the significance of the whole regression equation is very much there because this p-value is very low. I can tell you one thing to take the decision. If the p-value is very high, that means you can think that the regression equation actually means zero. There is no regression equation. Okay. If we have some had some slides, this is very, very important. Am I audible? Because
yes you are, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that is what I just thought that I can explain, but I'm sure that some of you may not be able to following this p-value thing, but I'm requesting you to just look through all these little literatures, because these are very important. Okay, now another thing is, let's say we found the regression equation is significant, and then we are going to predict some values, right? We are going to predict some values, and so how to do that? By the way, we can plot the regression line, best fitted regression line, along with the scatter plot like this also. Plot x comma y, ab line, and then lm within bracket y tilde x comma call equal to green. Okay, so this is also one way to plot the scatter plot along with the best fitted line. And now let's say we are going to predict some values of y given values of x, because prediction we do using the regression equation when it is significant. So we have taken two observations of x as a data frame in A. So we are taking it like this, and then x equal to, we are just seeing this x, and then we are predicting, let me make it bigger. Yeah, so we are taking observations in a data frame, new observations only on x. Note that only on x. Now we are going to use these values to predict the value of y using this regression equation. This regression equation means y equal to minus 38.45 plus 0.674 into x. Okay, so this is the data frame is set here, and then this is the code for prediction. The codes are very simple. So this is the object name. You can give any name you wish to, and then you can use the equal to sign as well. Then predict. This is a function in R, predict. You cannot change it. Predict, and then name of the function or regression equation, we gave the name as reg, comma A for this data set. And then pred means it will show the values. So I am running it. These are the observations. Let me change the values and let me change. Okay, so this is 47 and 48. Now if you just let me change it to 140. Okay, now run it once more. And then this, see, it got 55 and so on. So this is how you can use that particular data set to find the scatter plot and then to find the bar chart, pie chart, as well as box plots, then scatter plot, correlation coefficient, find the regression equation, prediction also. And if you can interpret the regression equation summary, that also you can do. Here what we have shown is that the same data, what we just discussed, shop data, we are plotting the scatter plot of age and income. Let me make it smaller so that you can see. So it is age and income, right? And then scatter plot we did. And then here we are doing age, income, color equal to rate, X level, Y level, and title, and abline also. Now see, when we run this line of code, we get this one. This is the scatter plot, and this is the fitted line, best fitted line. So that is how you can carry on your analysis just by going one by one. One thing I could not show, but I can, maybe I can show you in one line. Just that is how to check if there is any missing observation or not, because that is very important thing what we should look at. Let me bring one cell here. Let me bring one cell here and say sum equal to is dot na and then shop data. Probably this should work. Yeah. So let me show this one bigger. Yeah. So sum is dot na shop data equal to, and when we run this line of code, we got zero. Means is there any missing observation or sum of the missing observations? Sum means number of cells where there is no observations. So it is zero means there is no such observation. Actually, in real life, we see many data set where we see missing observations are there, and then we have to take decision whether we have to omit the entire cell or we have to replace the missing value with some estimated value or not. So that is called imputation of missing values. That is another type of analysis we normally do in real life. So that is, I think, very basic thing I could show, and the time is way I have taken overridden, so I'm sorry about that, and I think I should stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an interesting and informative session. Thank you so much.
I must say it is incomplete. It's not complete at all.
Yes. I'll just invite Umashankar Pandey sir and sir for your final comments so that we can wrap up today's session, because we are I guess out of time for question and answer. And if anybody, any of the participants, if they have questions, they can always mail us or write to us. Sir, over to you for your comments.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ghosh, for a masterclass. I mean, in 2 hours, we couldn't have done anything more than this. So thank you very much. So and the YouTube link will be there for everyone. And I know a lot of our scholars, they find it slightly intimidating. And this is what I was telling them, that, you know, there is a steep learning curve. But once you're there, and this question has to be, you know, answered, that how is that? Because people were asking that, how is it better than SPSS? Okay, you start off with SPSS and then you graduate to this, you know, computational thinking, because as you know, we'll have, you know, machine learning. We had planned to do tweet analysis as well. So there are lots of things that we can do with R. And, you know, as Dr. Ghosh was saying, you just need one line of code. And, you know, whether it's a linear model or whether it's a correlation or whether it's a regression or whatever, it's just there, you know, just one, kind of a line of code, and you have the results, and, you know, you can do so many things with them. So this kind of a thinking, you know, of just learning to, you know, just writing those codes, you know, just this very simple code, sum and mean and LM and, you know, AOV and all that, it doesn't take a lot of effort. But what we've done here is, you know, probably condensed maybe 5 or 6 hours into this 2 hours. So even I got a little bit greedy and, you know, went ahead where, you know, I should have stopped earlier. And then there was so much to learn from Dr. Ghosh's session. So I'm sure that some of you, I was very glad to see that, you know, some of the scholars have already saying that they have downloaded, you know, R onto their computers. So hopefully we'll have a lot more, you know, people working with. And there's no, I mean, as I was telling you, there is almost everything in statistics these days. I mean, and at the beginning as well, as I said, you know, machine learning is also, you know, applied statistics with computers. So, you know, you can't get away with it. You have to, you know, have this computational, you know, training of learning to code, because once you know one language, then you know Python and others. You know, basically, you know, if you know R, Python becomes easier, and if you know Python, R becomes easier. And there are, as Dr. Malik, you know, one of our senior colleagues is present. He was suggesting that there are so many things which are happening on a daily basis, and people are just, you know, sharing it, and that is what, you know, internet is all about. You know, collaborative learning. And that is what, you know, great teachers like Dr. Ghosh, you know, he took so much time and effort to, you know, explain it to people, you know, many of whom are, you know, not very conversant with statistics. But, you know, he you know, very expertly, you know, he took us to that level. I'm sure we'll carry this on in future as well. We enjoyed a lot, you know, presenting.
One simple point I would like to make to answer one question was asked, how it is different from SPSS. From our end, I would say we don't have to pay for it. That's the simplest answer I normally give, mm-hmm. because I don't want to get much into it, because if I don't have to pay and I have the liberty of work on anything, that is a great thing, because SPSS is hugely costly as far as my capability is concerned, and our most of the institutes are what I find similar to that.
Yeah, and you know, of course, so you know, this is a free and open source software, so you know, you keep learning about that, and as I said, you know, it's very intuitive. The problem is we are so used to working with those GUIs that, you know, if you have to write, you know, just line, you know, write even one install packages or whatever, we get some kind of a, you know, resistance. But once you get used to it, there's no going back, believe me. So now I'll hand it over to Dr. Ghosh once again for his final comments before we call it a day.
No, it's fine, but I would request you that simply for 1 hour or that smaller time, it's very difficult to make people understand that why do we need R and why should we get into this? Because what happens is, most of the time when people think that they have to write the code, no matter how small it is, they get scared of this, especially those who are not from science background. But I don't think coding is not to deal with anything with the science. Coding is kind of logic. And in coding in R or Python, it says that Python coding is like broken English. If you know English, you can write Python code. So R is also very similar to that. So you don't have to worry much on that, how to write the code, how can I get the mastery in the code. You start, it takes time to warm up the pan, but once it is warmed up, then you can cook very quickly. So maybe it will take 2 months to get used to in this. And most of the thing, see, most of the time we do very simple things in our research time, at least to start with. So let us start doing that in R. Tremendous helps are there in community, internet communities. So nothing to get worried. Maybe 10 years back, we did not have that much community help, but you got stuck somewhere. Just type in the Google, you will get plenty of answers. So who cares, who knows, who doesn't? So you just go ahead, work, and things will happen. That's how I can tell you.
And there are a lot of, you know, these stack exchanges. You just, you know, type in, you know, and everything is there. The code is there. You just have to copy it. And I'll invite Dr. Pradeep Malik. He's a very senior researcher. He's dean at Deen Dayal Petroleum University, Gandhinagar, and he joined us today. So, sir, if you want to say something.
Dr. Pandey, thank you for asking me to speak, but then this is not my day. This is your day and Dr. Ghosh's day. I joined in just to revise my R. You know, I learned it a long time ago. When and recently when I was using R, then I was pleasantly surprised to find, and I have written it to one of the respondents in the chat, that there are at least 16,000 ready packages for you.
Packages.
You are bound to find something that is, you know, something which is going to help you. So that is it. And thank you very much. I just joined because you people are doing a great job, fantastic job. Thank you, Dr. Pandey. And thank you, Ghosh.
Thank you, Professor Malik. I've already requested Dr. Ghosh for another session on tweet analysis. So we were planning to, you know, add a bit of it today as well, but, you know, that will be a separate one later on. So we'll be, you know, doing that. And it was such a, you know, a refreshing thing to see it, you know, we worked on Anaconda on Python. So nice to see, you know, R on Python, you know,
Anaconda. More beautiful to, communicate. That's very
right.
You can also try this. I mean, if you are not trying it, you should try it. I think it will like.
I work on Python with Anaconda, but I will definitely try with R.
You just use the same Anaconda.
I could understand. I will hopefully do that, and we'll probably. Yeah, Dr. Malik, you're saying something.
I just wanted to tell you, when you are organizing this Python thing, especially this Twitter analysis, I think people will need the API access. Not everybody will have it.
So, the Twitter thing, right?
API access to API. So maybe, you know, when you open this session or when you send out the invitation, you can ask them to apply for API, because it takes a few days for Twitter.
Yeah, the developer.
Sometimes actually it takes, depends, of course. I was lucky to get it in about 15 days or so, but I have heard people who have waited for three months.
These days they give it in one day. So
I tried it. I got in a single day, but I'm not.
Yeah, I also, you know, got it in one day. Probably, you know, you have to write the right words, you know, academic and, you know, all the, and it doesn't have to look like business. So if it looks academic, you know, yeah. Thank you for this conversation, and, you know, hopefully we'll have lots more about it, and hopefully we'll have more quantitative research in communication and media studies. So we are, I guess, on the right path. And thanks to, you know, benefactors like Dr. Ghosh, you know, we'll keep adding to our, you know, knowledge, you know, network. Thanks to everyone at the Media Watch, you know, for making this possible. So I must thank Mr. Patnaik, Mr. Jaina, Dr. Nayak, and everybody, you know, Dr. Patnaik, you know, for putting this together. So this is the second in the series. Hopefully we'll have more, and, you know, we'll keep coming back. Generally, you know, it was decided, or generally for these things, later on we'll try everyone to have a laptop, you know, so that we can share the data sets, you know, and you can work along. So for this, you know, just one way is, you know, some kind of a compromise that we're doing. So we would love to, you know, whenever we have it the next time, so we'll love to have, you know, participants with the laptops and with the data set, so that, you know, it will be even more effective. But if you will share the YouTube link along with the certificates that you'll be getting maybe tonight or tomorrow morning, so we'll provide you all this, you know, resources. So Dr. Ghosh, the last word is yours again.
No, thank you very much for having me. Maybe we can discuss more for other future issues, and I would request the participants to do practice, and that's the way you can get in touch with it and you can get the real taste of it. That's it. If you don't try, there is no point in watching the YouTube video and recording of these type of sessions. You have to work, then you will get the real beauty. That's it. Thank you very much for having me, and we'll see you again, hopefully.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you once more to the presenters. And thank you all for being here. We appreciate you being here. Thanks again for joining us today. And we will definitely see you all next time. So thank you.
Stop recording.